Good evening. I am Poonam Agarwal. I am working as a food analyst in Ashco Analytical Services. Today I am going to continue the discussion on the course BPVI 005 Food Microbiology of Diploma Program in Value Added Products from Fruits and Vegetables. As you know, this course is consist of four blocks. Block 1, Introduction, Controlling Microorganisms, Block 2, Block 3, Food Poisoning, and Block 4, Safe Chemical and Microbial Limits for Different Foods. Block 1 and Block 2, they are very well covered by Dr. Shruti and Dr. Vijay Sethi and Dr. Shruti Sethi. And I am going to cover this Block 3, that is Food Poisoning. This Block 3 consists of three units: Foodborne Disease, Foodborne Intoxications, and Bacterial Food Infections. So what is the need of studying foodborne diseases? As we know that food is the basic necessity of life, and if by our ignorance or due to lack of our knowledge, if it gets contaminated, then it poses health hazard to us. So to prevent health hazards and to prevent health risk, we must know about foodborne diseases. These diseases, basically foodborne diseases, these are the diseases caused by consuming contaminated food and beverages. This contamination can be bacterial contamination, or it can be chemical contamination, or it can be non-bacterial microbial contaminants, contamination like viruses, rickettsia, protozoa, parasitic worm, and fungi. Foodborne diseases, bacterial, that means when we discuss about bacterial contamination, then if food is contaminated by bacteria, then the foodborne diseases can be classified into two groups, that is foodborne intoxications and foodborne infections. Foodborne intoxications, as the name suggests, intoxication means toxins. If we consume toxins, if the food is contaminated by bacteria and it produces toxin, then the disease is termed as foodborne intoxications. Foodborne intoxications include botulism and staphylococcal intoxications. Foodborne infections, in this the microorganisms do not produce toxin, but food act as a carrier of microorganisms, and the person when ingested the food, these microorganisms get into the food and causes disease. Among foodborne infections, most common is salmonellosis. Then comes Clostridium perfringens illness, Bacillus cereus gastroenteritis, enteropathogenic E. coli infections, and some others are Yersiniosis, Shigellosis, Vibrio, Parahemolyticus. Then what happens when someone gets food poisoning? Diarrhea, it is the first and foremost symptom of food poisoning, or we can say foodborne illness. Then if diarrhea, it is accompanied by blood or mucus, then it is termed as dysentery. Abdominal cramps are common, nausea and vomiting are also there if a person is infected by pathogens. Among these symptoms, diarrhea and vomiting, these are very much common, and they are the body mechanism to preventive mechanism to get rid out of harmful chemicals from the body. Then if disease is caused by, if humans are infected by certain microorganisms, then these microorganisms are termed as pathogens. Pathogens can cause disease by two mechanisms. Either they invade the host tissue, that is, they invade the host tissues, they are termed as invasive microorganisms, and they also can produce toxins, then they are termed as toxigenic microorganisms. Toxigenic microorganisms, they may produce exotoxins or endotoxins. Exotoxins, these are basically proteinaceous in nature, and these are excreted outside in the environment by the microorganism. Whereas endotoxins, these are polysaccharide components of cell wall of bacteria, and they are not excreted in the environment. Or they come into the food only when the bacterial cell is lysed and it is disintegrated, then only these toxins come into the food. Then there are various factors leading to foodborne disease. Generally, it is seen that food mishandling is the major cause of foodborne disease, and out of which improper cooking of food is major cause of foodborne disease outbreaks. Other factors may include time lapse between preparation and serving, affected person touching the food, improper hot storage, cross contamination, use of leftovers, improper cleaning during preparation. These are certain factors which can cause foodborne diseases. If the contamination is due to chemicals, then these chemicals may cause disease, but it is not very common type of contamination. Chemical contaminants include fumigants. When steam sterilization is not practical for certain foods, then fumigation is done to sterilize the food. And among this, ethylene oxide is the most common fumigant used, and it reacts with the nutrients of food and destroy them. And ethylene oxide also reacts with the chloride ions in the food and form ethylene chlorohydrin, which is very toxic to human being. Other chemical contamination can occur by oil extraction solvents. Trichloroethylene, which was previously used as oil extraction solvent, it reacts with the food being processed and produce toxin. Most commonly used method for meat and fish preservation is smoking. It is very ancient practice to add flavor to the meat products as well as preserve it. But during smoking, certain polycyclic hydrocarbons like benzopyrene, it contaminate the food, and the food may become health hazardous. Then certain metals are also there. They can cause contamination like arsenic, antimony, cadmium, cyanide, fluoride, lead, selenium, mercury, and zinc. Antimony may come due to improper enameled cans, and arsenic, it is due to the sprays that are done on fruits to prevent microbial action. Then there is a list of toxic effects of certain metals and pesticides. Like we can see that arsenic, it may cause dizziness, cramps, and paralysis. Pesticides are very common nowadays, and they can cause liver, kidney, brain damage, and nerves also may damage. This may lead to death also. Tin poisoning may cause vomiting, photophobia, etc. Then if food is contaminated by microorganisms, it is not necessary that bacteria are the only source of contamination. There are certain microorganisms that are non-bacterial, like viruses, foodborne parasites, rickettsia, and fungus. Among viruses, hepatitis A virus, polio virus, and Norwalk virus are commonly seen to contaminate the food and cause foodborne disease. Foodborne parasites include trichinosis, amoebiasis, giardiasis, and ascariasis. They can also cause foodborne diseases. Rickettsia and fungus are certain other non-bacterial microbial contamination to food. Then first come the virus among non-bacterial contamination of food. The most common food source of gastroenteritis causing virus is shellfish. The first virus, that is hepatitis A virus. Hepatitis A virus cause disease, mainly jaundice, and the symptoms of jaundice are yellowness of eyes and lack of appetite, and it may lead to inflammation of liver. Incubation period of this microorganism is 15 to 45 days, and lifetime immunity usually results after a first attack. This is mainly transmitted through fecal oral route, and this virus, it is stable during refrigerated storage, and we can easily prevent this virus to contaminate the food by proper cooking, taking hygienic practices. Sanitation and personal cleanliness are very important to prevent infection from hepatitis A virus. Then next comes the polio virus. In India, large number of reported foodborne illnesses are due to the polio virus. It is very common among children of 5-year-old age, and milk is thought to be the most probable source of food contamination. The virus, it reproduces in the intestinal tract, and there it invades the motor cell of the central nervous system. Initially, the similar symptoms are almost seen in every foodborne disease, like gastroenteritis is very common in every foodborne disease, headache, muscle pain, and finally, if it is chronic, it is for long term, then it may cause paralysis also. That prevention include immunization of children, proper processing of milk, taking hygienic conditions, and also use of potable water help in prevention of polio virus. The next virus is Norwalk virus or Norwalk-like viruses. They are also termed as calciviruses. These are seen to be the important cause of gastroenteritis or gastrointestinal illness in US. The symptoms are include nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain, muscle ache, headache, dizziness, tiredness, and low-grade fever is also seen. Symptoms usually last for 24 to 48 hours, and if no treatment is given, then they subsides on their own. No long-term effect have been seen by this Norwalk virus. Transmission of this virus is through oral fecal route. Humans are the only source of these viruses, and these are transmitted to others if hands are not properly washed after a bowel movements. Basically, in all foodborne disease, hygienic practice is very important, and we should take sanitary measures to prevent these foodborne diseases. The next non-bacterial contamination is by rickettsias. Rickettsia, these are considered as degenerative bacteria because they have various characteristics, almost every characteristic of bacteria, but they cannot grow on their own. They are obligate parasites. They require a host to grow. Their mode of transmission is through bite of fleas, ticks, lice, etc. And the example of human rickettsial pox include epidemic typhus, rickettsial pox, Rocky Mountain fever, and Q fever. Generally, cows are infected by Q fever, and the organism that is involved in Q fever is Coxiella burnetii. So the Coxiella burnetii, it is excreted through the contaminated milk and may cause certain diseases. Therefore, milk is to be pasteurized at minimum 62.8 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes for complete destruction of microorganisms, so that rickettsia is not there and no disease will occur. Then other non-bacterial contamination of food is by foodborne parasites. Among foodborne parasites, first is the trichinosis. Trichinosis is caused by the Trichinella spiralis. Food source is the raw and incompletely processed pork containing the encysted larvae. Incubation period 1 to 2 days after the ingestion of encysted meat. Symptoms, again the same symptoms, initially gastroenteritis is seen, and finally it leads to paralysis, difficulty in breathing, chewing, and swallowing. So it can be prevented by cooking of pork till at least 58.3 degrees centigrade, quick freezing or storage as minus 15 degrees centigrade, irradiation or processing of sausage and similar meat products properly by salting, drying, smoking in refrigeration, and we must avoid feeding animal scraps or infected meat scraps to other animals so that no infection may occur. The next is amoebiosis. The causative organism is Entamoeba histolytica, which is a protozoa, and its mode of transmission is by oral fecal route. The humans are the carrier of this amoeba, and humans shed cysts in the feces, and by diagnosis of the feces we can find this disease. Fecal contamination of water and food, sexual contact, these are certain other mode of transmission of this amoebiosis. Symptoms may last for years. Maybe there may be no symptom of amoebiosis at all. There may be vague gastrointestinal distress. Dysentery may occur with blood and mucus. If there are complications, they may include ulcerative and abscess pain, and rarely intestinal blockage may also seen. Onset time is highly variable, and it may occur at any time that microorganism has infected the host, and disease may occur after 2 days or may 4 days or for months or years. It may take longer time also. Invasive dose, only one viable cyst is enough to cause the infection. Diagnosis is through stool examination for the cyst. Then next comes the Giardiasis. The causative organism is Giardia lamblia. Its incubation period is 1 week of ingestion of cyst. The dogs, cats, and wild animals, they are the carrier of disease. Symptoms are again same, diarrhea, gastrointestinal disturbances, Associated food are contaminated water, infected food handlers. So we must prevent these contamination. It is more prevalent in children than adults, among homosexual men, and also in child daycare centers where diapering is done. So there are more chances of contamination of water, and food handlers may also get infected in that places. Then next comes the ascariasis. Causative organism is Ascaris lumbricoides that cause ascariasis. It is also termed as roundworm infection. And other organisms include Trichuris, Trichura that cause trichuriasis. The diagnosis, it is done by examination of feces, or it may be diagnosed when crawling Ascaris comes into the throat and try to exit through nose, mouth, or through windpipe. Pneumonitis in the lungs is also common source of diagnosis. Symptoms include vague gastrointestinal discomfort, intestinal infection, and sometimes intestinal blockage may occur if the number of organisms are so many in the person, then intestine may get blocked. So surgical removal may also be required if this condition occurs. Mode of infection is through infected food handlers. So to prevent ascariasis, enthalmintic treatment is given to the patient, or otherwise surgical removal may be necessary. As I have already told, if the infection is heavy, then surgical removal is required. Then investigation of foodborne disease outbreak. How we investigate that foodborne disease has occurred? It is analysis is done through field analysis as well as laboratory analysis, and is generally taken by Ministry of Health. Objective of this investigation is to prevent and control the disease, to have a knowledge of disease causation, and to take administrative guidance to have the guidance like what should be taken, what precaution should be taken during the treatment of the disease. Then steps of investigations. This investigation is done in three steps. First is the field analysis, then laboratory analysis is done, and after that, these analysis, when this report comes, then interpretation of report is done by an epidemiologist. Then field analysis include gathering information about the disease, like what type of food was taken by the patient, how this food was prepared, who has prepared the food, and the locality where the foodborne infection was seen. Then sample collection, the infected sample is collected from the patient, their blood samples, their urine samples, they are taken and then analyzed for the bacteria, and then collection of specimen from human sources. Laboratory analysis include microbial as well as chemical analysis. After this, I will cover the food intoxication. Foodborne diseases, as I have already told, it is of two types, food intoxications and food infection. So first is food intoxication. Food intoxication may occur by two ways. Either a host ingests the toxin produced by microorganism, or natural toxin may also be present in the food. These toxins of microorganisms, these may be bacterial toxin or mycotoxins. Mycotoxins, these are the toxins produced by the molds in the food. Bacterial toxin, as the name suggests, bacteria produce the toxin. Bacterial toxin, among the most common bacterial toxins are botulism and staphylococcal food poisoning. Mycotoxins are aflatoxin, ochratoxin, patulin, citrullin, alternaria toxin, stigmatocystin, alternaria toxin, fusarium toxin, panicillic acid toxin. Various toxins are present in the pulses and cereals. These include trypsin inhibitors. Trypsin inhibitors are proteinaceous in nature, and they prevent the release of amino acid and thereby suppress the growth of the organism. Hemagglutinins are again proteinaceous, and they prevent the absorption of nutrients in the intestinal tract. Then come the cyanogenic glucosides. These are the cause of cyanide poisoning. These cyanogenic glucosides, these are hydrolyzed by alpha glucosidase enzyme in the intestine and produce hydrogen cyanide that cause poisoning. Then next is the saponins. Saponins are again high molecular glycosides. Then alkaloids, sometimes alkaloids may be present in the food. They are also a form of toxin. Goitrogens are the toxins that prevent the absorption of iodine and thereby causes goiter in the people. And then BOAA, beta oxalyl amino alanine, that cause lethargism. And this toxin is present in kesari dal. After a long consumption, nearly long consumption of high doses of kesari dal, 300 milligram per day, it may cause lethargism, which is a paralytic disease, and lower limbs of the person get infected. Hemolytic factor cause favism. Favism is a type of hemolytic anemia. Then oxalic acid. Oxalic acid may be present in the spinach and cause stone problem. Protease inhibitors may also be present. And algal and planktonic fish poisoning. If certain fishes which are infected by algae that are toxic, then consumption of these fishes may also cause poisoning. Then food intoxication can easily be prevented by soaking, heating and fermentation of pulses. If soaking is done, then maximum toxins, they are leached out in the water and toxins are eliminated. Then heating denature the protein like trypsin inhibitors and hemagglutinins and certain enzymes like alpha glucosidase, they are destroyed by heating. Then fermentation of pulses destroy the toxic factors and yield more digestible and highly nutritive value products. Then mycotoxins, I have already told you that these are the toxins produced by molds. These are secondary metabolites produced by the molds on the foodstuffs that cause illness or death. Whereas primary metabolites, they are produced during the exponential growth of the bacteria, whereas secondary metabolites have no effect on the growth. One, they are very much toxic, but less toxic than botulism toxin. The syndrome due to ingestion of toxin in a mold contaminated food is referred as mycotoxicosis. Initially, mycotoxins were first of all found in the elementary toxic Eleuchia disease, which was outbreak in Russia. This is caused by T2 toxin produced by Fusarium sporotrichoides, and other disease, yellow rice disease, it was seen in Japan and it was caused by Penicillium islandicum. Then among mycotoxins, the most commonly studied mycotoxin is aflatoxin. Aflatoxin is produced by the Aspergillus flavus, Aspergillus parasiticus and Aspergillus nominus mold. It was first of all seen when 1000 turkey died in England due to consumption of peanut meal, and when it was diagnosed, then Aspergillus flavus was the causative organism found. The name aflatoxin is itself derived from aflatoxin from Aspergillus flavus toxin. Aflatoxin B1 is the most toxic, and toxicity of the six most potent aflatoxins decreases in the following order. The most lethal is B1, then followed by M1, G1, B2, M2 and G2. M1 stands for toxin produced by the cows in milk. It is most commonly present in the crops like groundnuts, corn, but it can also occur in certain temperate crops such as wheat. Aflatoxicosis is a term given to food infected by aflatoxin, and it is a disease. Biological effects include hepatitis. It is carcinogenic. This toxin also causes liver necrosis. M1, M2 that are excreted in milk are less toxic than the parent compound B1. Then it can be controlled by chemical treatment. There are certain sophisticated instruments that can sort out the infected grain and we can discard them. There is other method we can choose, like integrated agriculture program, to control the toxin production at field level and to grow varieties that are not toxic. Then next toxin produced by moles are ochratoxin. Ochratoxin A is produced by Penicillium varicosum in temperate climate in most, and it is most common in stored cereal. Certain species of Aspergillus also produce toxin in warmer and tropical parts of the world. Aspergillus ochraceus is common in coffee beans, spices, soya bean, groundnuts, rice and corn. Ochratoxin is most heat resistant, and once it is produced, it is not destroyed by any heat treatment. Either we autoclave it or roast it. This toxin is not destroyed at all. Ochratoxin causes Balkan endemic nephropathy. It is nephrotoxic, and this toxin is also hepatotoxic. Liver may get damage. It is carcinogenic also. It suppresses the immunity of human body, and it inhibits protein synthesis, protein biosynthesis in human. LD50 for this ochratoxin is 20 to 22 milligram per kilogram. LD50 is lethal dose 50. It is the dose that cause 50% person to get infected by consumption of this toxin. Control can be done either by cooking with or without previous soaking of the beans, but it does not lead to complete destruction. And this toxin is, because it is heat resistant, it is very difficult to remove this toxin. Then other mycotoxin is Petulin. It is a toxic metabolite produced by Penicillium expansum, and this is a soft rot pathogen in apples, and it is found in the range of foods based on fruits. Presence of Petulin in fruit juice is the indicator that fruit juice has been taken from the infected, from the poor quality fruit. This mycotoxin is found in the moldy bread, sausage, certain fruits like banana, pineapple, pears, grapes, peaches and other products. Petulin, it is teratogenic, it is also immunotoxic, it is neurotoxic, gastrointestinal disturbances are seen in rats, chromosomal aberrations occur if petulin is ingested, and it is also a carcinogen. It can be controlled by removing the lesion, like if it is apple, then by removing the infected part, about 90% toxin is removed, and if 1 centimeter around the lesion is also removed, then nearly 99% of this toxin is removed. Ascorbic acid is also seen to reduce the level of petulin, whereas pasteurization has very little effect on the destruction of petulin. Then the other foodborne intoxication that is very common in human is botulism. It is a neuroparalytic disease caused by the ingestion of toxin produced by Clostridium botulinum. There are 7 types of Clostridium botulinum present in food. On the basis of their serological specificity, they are classified as A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. In among these 7 toxins, A, B, E, F, and G, they cause disease in human, whereas C and D, they are found to cause disease in cattle. This toxin are simple and they are heat labile, and if we give proper heat treatment like 80 degrees centigrade for 10 minutes, this toxin is completely removed. This toxin prevents the release of neurotransmitter acetylcholine. As a result, paralysis may occur. 3 types of botulism is seen. First is the adult botulism, infant botulism and wound botulism. Adult botulism, it is due to the ingestion of toxin, and it may take 12 to 36 hours to produce the symptoms, and the major symptoms include dryness of the skin, throat and mouth, and there may be respiratory failure, and death occurs in the severe condition when respiratory failure occur. Infant botulism, it is due to the ingestion of botulism endospores. When these come in the food, they can cause disease. Wound botulism, it is very rare. In this, food is not involved at all, and the bacteria, they infect the wound and get penetrated into that particular area and may cause disease. then certain foods which are associated with botulism, they are the foods with low acidic foods. They have the pH greater than 4.6. Improperly heat processed canned foods are the common cause of botulism. Foods that are not heated before consumption, they can also cause botulism. Improperly preserved foods, they cause botulism. Certain examples of food that can cause botulism are canned corns, pepper, mushroom, green bean soups, asparagus, spinach, sausage, smoked and salted fish. Botulism can be prevented by proper heat giving proper heat treatment to food. Strict adherence to safe food practices in the food industries is very important to control the botulism. Education of public on safe home preservation, that is canning method for food. An infant must not fed with honey during the first year of age. And the person should not taste any food that have objectionable flavor. Early administration of botulism antitoxin and intensive supportive care, including mechanical breathing assistance, can also help to control the botulism. Then other foodborne intoxication that is very common is staphylococcal food poisoning. The organism is Staphylococcus aureus that produce heat-stable enterotoxin. The source of this staphylococcal food poisoning is improperly cooked and stored ham, processed meats, chicken, salad, pastries, pre-cooked and frozen foods, ice creams. Humans, they are the primary reservoir of this microorganism, and they are present in nasal passage, throat, hair and skin of healthy people. And less than 1 microgram dose of this toxin may be very infectious to human being, and after consumption of this toxin in very minute quantities, after 1 to 6 hours of ingestion, the disease symptoms may be seen. The symptoms include severe abdominal pain, diarrhea, vomiting, sweating, headache, prostration, nausea, and sometimes a fall in body temperature is also reported. Then staphylococcal food poisoning can be prevented by taking good personal hygiene measures, adequate refrigeration of food, adjustment of more pH, more acid pH, heating susceptible food rapidly to 65 to 70 degrees centigrade for 12 to 15 minutes. Prolonged storage at room temperature should be avoided, and products that receive only a minimal heat treatment, they must not store at room temperature for a longer period of time. Then other foodborne disease include bacterial food infection. It is thought to be a public health problem. Bacterial food infection occur when a person ingests the food that have microorganisms in it, and these microorganisms, when ingested, they cause disease to the human. When a pathogen enters the gastrointestinal tract and it multiply, it causes bacterial food infection. Pathogens can infect the food in two ways. Pathogen can penetrate into the intestinal mucosa, or it can pass through the intestine, through the systemic organs. Zoonotic diseases. These are the diseases or infections that are transmitted between the vertebrate animals and the human being. These include that the infections that are directly transmitted from animal to human, for example, rabies. The other method include the mode of transmission is through contaminated food like salmonellosis, and those having animal reservoir and transmitted through mosquitoes and other arthropods to human, like Rocky Mountain spotted fever. How these zoonotic diseases get transmitted? These zoonotic diseases can be transmitted through feces, urine, blood, saliva, milk, via aerosol, via oral contact with animals, or by bedding of animals also. The first and most common infection by food is salmonellosis. It is also termed as Salmonella gastroenteritis. It results from the ingestion of food contaminated with large number of viable cells, that is around 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 9 Salmonella bacteria. Symptoms include nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, diarrhea occurs suddenly, preceded by headache and chills. The difference between food intoxication and foodborne infection is that when toxin are ingested, no fever occur, whereas when the bacteria is ingested, that is foodborne infection is there, then mild fever is seen. Other evidence of the disease are watery, greenish, foul-smelling stools, prostration, muscular weakness, faintness, usually a mild fever, restlessness, twitching, and drowsiness. Prevention of outbreak. This salmonellosis can be prevented by avoiding use of animal products from domestic livestock, avoid use of food ingredients that are common source of salmonellosis, process all susceptible food to salmonella to at least 66 degrees centigrade for 12 to 15 minutes. Refrigerate all the food susceptible to salmonella contamination. Then other foodborne infection is by E. coli. It is termed as enteropathogenic E. coli. The E. coli gastroenteritis syndrome is caused by the ingestion of large number of E. coli, that is 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 10 viable cells per gram, that must colonize the small intestine and produce enterotoxin. The symptoms include non-bloody, watery diarrhea without inflammatory exudates. Common symptoms are cramps, chills, vomiting, and incubation period is 2 days and the disease may last for 8 days. E. coli food infection can be of three types: enteropathogenic E. coli, enteroinvasive, and enterotoxigenic E. coli. Enterotoxigenic E. coli produce two types of toxin, that is heat stable toxin and heat labile toxin. Enteroinvasive E. coli, that these E. coli invade in the large intestine and can produce disease. Then E. coli outbreak can be prevented by avoiding contaminated water and food. Avoid unpasteurized juices, use adequate cooking procedures for destruction, and antibiotics and antidiarrheal drugs that people usually take, they are not very helpful. Then other infection is Bacillus cereus gastroenteritis. It is not very common cause of food poisoning, and generally similar symptoms of foodborne infections are seen in it also. Cereals are the main food that are the carrier of Bacillus cereus microorganism. Next is the Vibrio parahemolyticus gastroenteritis. Various infections are seen from bacteria, and so various foods are associated with it, but Vibrio parahemolyticus is mainly due to the seafoods. The infective dose is greater than 10 to the power 6 viable cells, and the major source is seafood, so consumption of raw and improperly cooked seafood should be avoided. Then other common foodborne infection is Shigellosis, bacterial dysentery. Shigellosis is caused by the genus Shigella, and very few colony forming units, like 10 colony forming units of Shigella dysentery in susceptible individuals can cause disease, and mode of transmission is by oral fecal route. Shigellosis symptoms include abdominal pain, cramp, inflammation, elevation in body temperature. There may be kidney failure, jaundice, persistent internal bleeding. The infection is only in the large intestine.